Following is a recording of a live questions and answers session with Chris McCann that took place on Sunday, October 19th, 2014.
Hello and welcome in to eBible Fellowship's Questions and Answers Time, where you can interact with us with your questions and comments related to the Bible, and we'll try to respond as well as possible by going to the Bible. And now with Sunday afternoon's questions and answers, here's Chris McCann.
Good afternoon and welcome everyone to eBible Fellowship Sunday afternoon question and answer program. During this time, we're going to take a look at the Bible with any questions or comments that anyone may have. And each person is invited to share what's ever on your mind by giving us a call or contacting us. And one of the ways that we're mentioned, we'll be glad to receive your question or comment, and I'll try to respond as much as possible by turning to the Bible, God's holy word. And it is the Bible that is our refuge and strength. It is the Bible that is our comfort, the Bible that will permit us to endure. God's word will carry his people forth day by day throughout these dark days of judgment unto the very end. And we can be sure of that. God will not let any of his true people, his chosen ones, fail. He will not permit them to be burned up in this spiritual fire, but they will endure to the end. And that's why the Lord says, the one that endures to the end shall be saved. It is not our endurance to the end that saves us, but it is because he has saved us that we will endure to the end. All right, well, at this point, we're going to open up the room to the first caller. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Yes, good afternoon, brother. How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you.
Okay, my question today is coming from the book of Matthew, chapter 24. And in that book, Matthew 24, it tells us four times, of the word, the end. It's in verse 3, verse 6, verse 13, and verse 14. My question is looking at verse 12 and 13. Now, verse 13, we know what it says about, you know, I'm sorry, my question is from verse 13 and 14. And verse 14, we know that it talks about this gospel shall be preached into the kingdom. And, you know, and we know that leading up to May 21st, that verse was carried out by God. God alone, but everything was preached into all the ends of the world. And we thought, or I thought at that time, that after that gospel was preached, then the last elect would have been brought into the kingdom, and that would have been the end. But we're still here past that time. Now, when I look at verse 13, it says, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Now, I'm just wondering, is verse 13 saying those who shall endure to the end shall be saved, is that the end of the world? And is verse 14 saying that this gospel shall be preached well and then the end shall come, is that saying that's the end of salvation?
Well, you're asking a good question. I understand what you're asking. When does the end take place? Was May 21, 2011 the end? Is, if we're correct, October 7th, 2015 the end? And I think if we look at it in the same way, we would look at the language of Judgment Day. Judgment Day is the end. It is the end of the world. And so May 21, 2011 was Judgment Day, and yet so is today, this present day we're living, and so tomorrow until God completes the judgment. It's a prolonged period of time, we've come to learn, yet it's all viewed as judgment day. Well, it's the same thing when we read of the end. Remember what was said to Daniel in the book of Daniel, seal up the word till the time of the end. And by giving us that statement, God was indicating the end begins at the beginning of the Great Tribulation. And that is when judgment began at the house of God. So and there is actually a couple of verses where the Lord speaks of the day of wrath, where it seems to even flow or overflow into the Great Tribulation period. So in other words, he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. And there was a matter of enduring faithful teaching up to Judgment Day, May 21, 2011. And yet we know that it's God's plan for this period of time to try his people. And what have we seen? That a good number of people that perhaps would have qualified up until May 21, 2011, if you were to look at them, did they endure sound doctrine to that point? Well, as far as we know, yes. But in this period of time, no. No, the spiritual fire, the scorching from this burning sun is driving them away. And it's too much affliction, too much for the gospel's sake. And so they're going back. And so we can know that the end in verse 13 has in view the very end of the world. It's not just the end that began at the Great Tribulation. It's not the end that began at the beginning of Judgment Day on May 21, 2011, but it's the very end of all things. And that is the end. God can call that the end. Then in verse 14, and this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. And so the gospel was preached throughout the nations during the church age, and then the Great Tribulation came, which I think has some tie into this. But then in a major way, unprecedented, God brought forth the gospel to all the world a second time with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in the latter rain, the second part of the Great Tribulation. And the nations heard like never before. And then came Judgment Day, the end. Legitimately, God can call that the end, but it's not the very end of the world, and until we complete the whole period of the end or the whole period of Judgment Day.
Okay, but can we also talk about the end of salvation in verse 14? Did that verse be saying that?
Well, I don't. The end is I suppose we could understand as a synonym for judgment. Then will Judgment Day come, and included in Judgment Day is the end of salvation. So that is the judgment of God. So in that sense, it's being viewed in that verse.
Okay, because what you're teaching now, what we're learning now, that salvation has ended May 21st, 2011. I totally agree with that. As we read that verse 14, it says the gospel shall be preached. It was preached and lead up to May 21st. And then after that time, there was no more preaching of that gospel of salvation. But now we're feeding the sheep in this period of time. So I'm just wondering, I was just trying to tie in.
Well, God isn't saying that he, in verse 14, it doesn't say the gospel will end, or the preaching of the word of God will end. It just says the end will come, and we have to look elsewhere to find out, well, what does that mean? And that means judgment, God's wrath. The day of judgment will come, and it did. God preached the world into preached the gospel into all the world, and following that, the end came when God shut the door of heaven, and this period of judgment day began. We're living in the end. You know, the whole New Testament era, I think, in one place was called the last days, or I can't remember exactly how it's put, but God views since the cross as though these are the last days, and then he speaks of the beginning of the Great Tribulation from the book of Daniel as the end, and Judgment Day as the end, and then there is the very complete end of all things, the end of the world, which occurs at the last day of Judgment Day, and there's a good probability that will take place October 7th next year. But thank you for calling and sharing those verses. And let's take a question from Skype. The question is it okay for a child of God to wear mini shorts and mini skirts and skimpy clothing? Would this be setting a bad example and condoning prostitution, or is it okay? Well, the child of God is given direction concerning what we wear in, in 1 Peter 3, it says in verse 2, and this is speaking of a wife, but it has application to women in general, says, while they behold your chaste conversation coupled with fear, and conversation is behavior, whose adorning, let it not be that outward adorning of plaiting the hair and of wearing of gold or of putting on of apparel, but let it be the hidden man of the heart in that which is not corruptible, even the ornament of a meek and quiet spirit, which is in the sight of God of great price. Now, if this is true of the wife with the husband, it's definitely true of the single woman, that a woman would want to be modest in her appearance, just as a man would want to wear modest clothing. We're a witness, we're a Christian, so we want to share Christ. We want the attention of others to be on the Lord, not on ourselves. And that's where clothing comes in. Of course, when people are getting haircuts and making designs in their hair, or they're getting tattoos or wearing jewelry in such a way, or they're wearing very tight-fitting clothing, very little clothing, why are they doing it? To draw attention to themselves, to some part of them, and they want the attention. They're trying to attract other people, in some cases, to them, and in some way or another. But the believer's focus is not on ourself. That's the focus of man. Man and his pride, and or woman also, just using man in general, wants to be the focus of attention. We want others to be drawn to us, and we want them to admire our intellect, our body, or whatever it is. We want to be lifted up by their attention. But that is not, again, the focus of the child of God. We want others to see Christ. And so we don't cut our hair to draw attention to ourselves. We don't wear jewelry, outlandish jewelry, to draw attention to ourselves. We don't get tattoos to draw attention to ourselves, or wear certain kinds of clothing to draw attention to ourselves. We want to look nice. We want to be presentable, yet very in a modest way, We just want our outward conversation, what is visible to others, to not be an offense and to not take away the focus from Christ. And so that's why woman who's a child of God would also want to wear modest clothing. And especially there are other considerations in this day and age when people are so given over to the lust of the eyes and to the pride of life. And if we're dressing in a way that would attract someone's attention that way, well, we're not helping them at all. We don't want to contribute in any way to someone else's sinful problems that they have. Maybe we ourselves don't have a problem in that area, but we wouldn't want to contribute to someone else in any way tempting to them. But thank you for your question. Let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Morning, Brother Chris, and to all the listeners. Mine is regarding today's reading, Ephesians 1, Ephesians 1, verse 10. I want to relate the fullness of time to Luke 9, verse 50, and then Acts 2, verse 1. It seems like, you know, spiritually that the feast days are when the Lord gathers his people. And if you can tie that into how we've learned about what they mean in Judgment Day, like hopefully you understand my question.
What was the verse in Acts? Was it Acts 9:50?
Acts 2:1.
Oh, I'm sorry, Luke.
Luke 9, verse 50.
50, okay. Well, let's read these verses. Ephesians 1, verse 10, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him. And over in Luke...
No. I thought it was 50. I'm trying to... Let's go to the Acts 2:1 until I find the
Okay. One Luke 2. All right. Acts 2:1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And...
Are you
thinking about the time of their visitation?
Passover, when Jesus said, "My time is not fully come," and he was talking about the Passover.
Oh, that's in John 7. Let's see. John 7, when his brethren were telling him to go up to the feast. In John 7:6, then Jesus said unto them, "My time is not yet come, but your time is all we ready. Go ye up unto this feast. I go not up yet unto this feast," in verse 8, "for my time is not yet full come." Well, yeah.
Yeah,
you're,
it's the same word, it's the same fully come in all those verses.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're, I think, tying the right verses together. God is indicating in Ephesians that there is a dispensation of the fullness of times. And what do those fullness of times involve? Gathering together in one all things in Christ. And so in Acts, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, it was the time to pour out the Holy Spirit and to gather in the first fruits, that those saved during the church age. And then God speaks of the day of tabernacles. That's the feast that's in view in John 7, fully coming. And we know that the Lord spoke of three main feasts: Passover, which also unleavened bread, Pentecost, first fruits, and the final feast of tabernacles in gathering, held at the end of the year. And so these three main feasts relate to three harvests and three rains. The early righteous rain produced the harvest or the fruit of Christ, the Lamb of God. And when he went to the cross, it was exactly the purpose that God designed for the nation of Israel. He was the fruit, the first of the first fruits. And then came the outpouring of the early rain throughout the New Testament church age to bring in the first fruits, all those saved via the churches and congregations. And then when that time period was completed, there is also always a famine. It's rain, fruit, famine that's involved in these three seasons. Then was a great tribulation famine of 2300 evening days, followed by another period of rain, the latter rain, and the bringing in of the final harvest of the great multitude out of great tribulation. And it's all according to the dispensation of the fullness of times, the times and seasons. And that's why the biblical calendar of history is so tremendously important. And for people to cast it aside, to cast it away, to go back from it, and to deny that is a accurate and faithful biblical, that means from the Bible, calendar, will leave them in darkness concerning God's program of times and seasons. They won't know where they're at in history, in time. They won't know what season they are in. And that's why when people have gone back from May 21, 2011, and back from the biblical calendar, they go back to church because they don't see the fullness of time, that the first fruits are already gathered and that rain is over and done with, and they don't recognize the latter rain has already come and so forth. And now people who are denying things, they're not recognizing the latter rain is complete or the great tribulation is ended. And it's all related to ignorance, in some cases, willful ignorance of the biblical calendar of history, which was absolutely necessary for God to open up in order that his people have a proper understanding of times and seasons. Remember what it said in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 in verse 1, "But of the times and the seasons, brethren, ye have no need that I write unto you, for yourselves know perfectly that the day of the Lord so cometh as a thief in the night." And then God speaks of not being caught as a thief because you're of the day and not of the night, and only those of the night will be taken as a thief. And how is that possible? Because the Lord's plan was to inform us, to make us aware of the proper time and season, to teach us of time and judgment, and that's what he did. And now he is trying us to see if we're going to hold on to those faithful, sound doctrines, or if we're going to go back. But thank you very much for those verses. And let's take another. Well, I'm sorry, we have several people on the phone this afternoon. So we're going to go to the next caller. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Hi, Chris. Can you read Matthew 24, 12 and 13, please?
Matthew 24, 12.
Matthew 25.
Matthew 25, 12 and 13.
Yes.
But he answered and said, Verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for ye know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh.
So in verse 13, when it says ye, isn't he talking about the unbelievers? The five foolish virgins?
Well, we have to keep in mind that God sealed up the information until the time of the end. And he discouraged looking into end time things through giving these scriptures, saying, no man knows a day or hour. You know neither the day nor hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. It's not of you, it says in Acts 1:7, to know the times or the seasons. And so God gave those verses. He even allowed the translators to translate it, it's not for you, rather than the correct, have the genitive case translated correctly as of you. And that's what's in view. Because it's not of you, the true believer or unbeliever, it's not of man in any way to know these things. We cannot possibly know anything about the end or the conditions of the end. Who would have known centuries ago of the world that we have today? What man could have thought that at the time of the end of the world, men would be marrying men in a common way and women marrying women in a very acceptable way by all the nations? And it's even a good thing that nobody could have foreseen that. Or who would have been able to foresee the desolation of a church that has women pastors and homosexual bishops and congregations that fall over backwards and congregation after congregation that are standing on their feet, clapping and dancing and waving their arms in the air. No man could have envisioned these things, but God did. And so he wrote about them in the Bible, in Romans 1. He wrote about it in Matthew 24, in 2 Thessalonians 2, the falling away first. But he kept the timetable of times and seasons from us because the word was sealed. And that's why it was extremely important to watch. And whenever we read of no man knows, as it says here, we'll also find what seemingly is almost a contradictory statement, watch therefore. You would think, well, if I can't know, if no man can possibly know anything concerning time and seasons and judgment, that what's the sense of watching? And that is exactly what the church tells their congregation. You can't know. You can't know where we're at, how long it'll be. Christ may come today. He may come in 1,000 years. You can't know. But watch. Well, what are they supposed to do? How are they supposed to watch? Are they to look up in the sky each day? I don't see Christ coming today. No, they're basically telling their congregation to be watchmen that are blind, and watchmen that are like a dumb dog that cannot bark. Yes, go watch, but you can't ever see anything. Go watch, but you can't ever know when he's coming, so you better not sound any kind of warning alarm. And that's the contradiction. The Lord, in telling us to watch, was implying in that statement that at some point, some future point, you keep watch because you will gain insight. A wise man's heart discerneth time and judgment. The Lord God will do nothing, but he revealeth his secret to his servants, the prophets. and so forth. God gave many encouragements that he does reveal things in advance concerning judgment to his people. That's what he did with Noah. That's what he did with Lot. That's what he did with Jonah, and so forth. And so it was a command to watch in the Bible, because the people of the past, and we ourselves, perhaps for a time, were reading the Bible, and it was not of us to bring about the time or season. But when the time came, God opened the scriptures, and those watching would now be able to understand. The wise will understand, but none of the wicked will understand. And God's people were then able to, by the grace of God, see the times and seasons for the church age, for the duration of the Great Tribulation, for Judgment Day, and so forth. But thank you for bringing up those verses. And let's take a question from Pal Talk. Isn't it true that Christ Jesus was born early in the month of October, 7 BC, on our calendar, and the outstanding likelihood of the last day being early on in October 2015? Is there any significance with these two dates? And do you know the dates on the Hebrew calendar and how many days of or years between the two? Well, we know that, yes, when we work out the birth of Christ through the information that God gives concerning John the Baptist's birth, that's the key to understanding when Jesus was born, because of John's father, Zacharias, was in the temple performing his course of Abia, I think it is, which was in the, I think it was the fourth month. And anyway, it can be calculated when he was in the temple, when he saw the vision, when he left to go home to his wife Elizabeth, and the Bible indicates that the conception of John would not have been too long after that. And then we can figure, we know when John the Baptist was conceived, a pretty good reckoning of that. And we know when Elizabeth went to Mary, when she was in a certain month, and the Bible tells us how far along John was, and we know when at that point Jesus was so old. And then we can calculate from there and go 9 months, and we have a very good estimate that the Lord was born early October, probably around the 2nd of October in 7 BC, which was a Jubilee year. And so, yes, we could add 7 BC to 2015, and we get 2022 calendar years, or 2021 actual years. And I know I've tried to break them down. I don't remember if they break down to any significant numbers, but I'm sorry, I can't remember how those numbers break down, but that would be the length of time from the birth of Christ until the Feast of Tabernacles next year in 2015. But thank you for your question. Let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Hi, Chris. Could you please read Ecclesiastes 5, verse 1, and Hosea 6, verse 4 to 6?
Ecclesiastes 5, 1 says, keep thy foot when thou goest to the house of God, and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they consider not that they do evil. And then Hosea 6, 4 to 6. O Ephraim, what shall I do unto thee? O Judah, what shall I do unto thee? For your goodness is as a morning cloud, and as the early dew, it goeth away. Therefore have I hewed them by the prophets, I have slain them by the words of my mouth, and thy judgments are as the light that goeth forth. For I desired mercy and not sacrifice, and the knowledge of God more than burnt offerings.
Could you explain those that make sacrifice without hearing the law of God?
Where is that found? Which verse?
Those that make sacrifices, give the sacrifice of fools.
Oh, okay.
In Ecclesiastes.
Okay, Ecclesiastes 5, 1 again says, keep thy foot when thou goest to the house of God. And what would that refer to? Well, we know the foot and hand in the Bible ties in with the will, or represents the will of man. And so basically, don't do your own will. Be considerate and mindful of God's will, and be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they consider not that they do evil. Well, the way God has written this, he mentions this kind of thing, or this idea, in the book of James in the New Testament, how it's much better to listen, to hear, than to speak. For instance, in James chapter 3, and here it's in the context of masters or teachers in verse 1. My brethren, be not many masters, knowing that we shall receive the greater condemnation. For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body. And then in verse 5, even so, the tongue is a little member and boasteth great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindleth, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and is set on fire of hell. And then God says, all kinds of beasts and things have been tamed. But verse 8, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. And so God does speak of giving the sacrifice of our lips in other places. And here it's encouraged, and God is saying, look, it's much better to hear when you go to the house of God, when we go to the kingdom of God, when we go to the word of God. Be more ready to hear than to give the sacrifice of fools, that is, to speak without wisdom, to speak without grounding in the Bible, in God's word. And that's what many teachers have done, many that take the word of God in their mouth and proclaim it without carefully making sure that the conclusions, that the doctrines they're teaching are in line with everything else in the Bible. Maybe they made sure their conclusions are in line with their church's confession and creed, or their conclusions are in line with what they learned in seminary from the theologians, or and yet not in line with the Bible. And this, I think, is what's being referred to as the sacrifice of fools, the offering of their lips in testimony to God, or in a declaration of the word of God. It's not a good sacrifice, because it's coming from a fool, from an unsaved individual. But thank you for bringing up those verses. And let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Yes, hi. You mentioned earlier a couple of days ago about the word Gethsemane and the definition of it, which Geth means can mean pressed, and Gethsemane can mean oil or fruit, olive. And is there any connection between the old traditions, what Aaron used to do, which was to collect oil and then light the candles, the seven candles?
Well, yes, Gethsemane is the word in the New Testament for the garden that the Lord entered in, and it's found twice. And in each case, in Matthew and in Mark, as soon as Christ goes into Gethsemane, almost immediately, there is as though he's beginning to suffer the wrath of God. And that's because it does picture the place of the wine press or the oil press. Geth, let's see if I remember this right. Yes, semen is the word for oil or fruit, and it comes from the Old Testament, 8081 in Strong's Concordance. And Gat, G-A-T, or Geth, is the word for press, 1660 in Strong's Concordance. And the two words are put together to indicate a press of the fruit, the olive or the oil, and it's squeezed out. And this pictures the Holy Spirit oftentimes when David was anointed by Samuel. He was anointed with oil. And that is picturing the Holy Spirit coming upon David. Or in other cases, I'd have to look at the word to see if it's the same word. But it is normally what's in view when we read of that word oil. So as Christ enters Gethsemane, he begins to suffer the wrath of God. God already, by the very name of the place, is picturing the fruit that was Christ being pressed, and out comes the oil, olive, or out will come the Holy Spirit. And soon after, at the appointed time, when Pentecost was fully come, the Holy Spirit is officially poured out.
Hello?
Yes.
Yeah, wow, that's beautiful. So there is a connection between Aaron in the old times collecting the oil, and then the oil would light the candle. So the oil is the Holy Spirit. I would say so,
but again, I would feel more comfortable if you had a verse and I looked up the word for oil, because it could be possible that the word oil for oil there is a different word. That generally is the picture when the daily, the light of the candle was to ever be burning. That is the picture of God's presence with Israel, the gospel light. And that's why when we read of the daily being taken away in Daniel and the abomination set up, it's a picture of the Holy Spirit coming out of the church and Satan entering in. And so there could be that relationship with the oil that would keep the daily burning, the light burning. But thank you.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for calling and sharing. And let's take another question from Pal Talk. The question is, someone called on last Friday night study regarding the verse that mentioned heaven and earth shall pass away. She was asking you to explain the meaning of Matthew 24:35. Let's see, Matthew 24, verse 35 says, heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass away. Well, I didn't understand what she was asking, but if that's what she was asking, the Bible does say that, yes, this heaven, this present heaven, and it would be the sky that's above, the Bible calls heaven, as well as the universe, space that's out there is also called heaven. And earth, this world, will pass away. God's plan is to destroy this creation and to then recreate a new heaven and a new earth. And there are some people, because there can you can find a couple of verses in the Bible that speak of the world continuing on forever, and they actually think it's referring to this world. Or some people have the idea that the vast universe will not be destroyed, it'll only be the world, and they're both wrong. And like anything else, we have to look at all that's said in the Bible about it and harmonize our conclusions. And the Bible is absolute in its declaration. This world that has been cursed after man fell into sin, God cursed the creation, and that means the universe out there in space, however far someone could ever get in traveling to or see through a telescope, the whole universe is also cursed because it's part of the creation. And God would not have a sinful man, a rebellious creature, ruling over a perfect creation. So everything is cursed, contaminated by sin, and therefore everything must be destroyed. But one thing is eternal, the word of the Lord. God himself is eternal. His word is eternal. His word will not pass away. And yes, on one hand, that's Christ, who is the embodiment of the word, the essence of the word of God. But we shouldn't doubt that somehow God's word will exist into eternity future. But thank you for bringing up this verse. And let's go to the next person on the phone this afternoon. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Good afternoon, Brother Chris. Brother Chris, I was looking at Jeremiah 50, verse 44. And I'm not sure, but I have an idea about that. I'm wondering, could that be the he and the her is the same? Like God uses, different images of Satan in Revelation. The he and the her in Jeremiah 44, could that be a picture of the false gospels in our time? And the reason why I say that term from the swelling of Jordan, when you look at that in the Strong's, the Strong's number for that is 1347, and it's used 49 times. 20 of those times is pride, 2 is arrogancy, 1 is pride, and another one is pomp, which also could be in the negative. So could it be a picture of the false gospel in our time? Because Jordan is a picture of crossing the final leg, crossing into the promised land, which seems to be kind of like the time that we're in. And then when I read, and it says that, but I will make them run away from her. So again, the he and the her could be the same, typifying the false gospel in our time. And God, you know, what comes to mind with these questions where who is a chosen man? Who is like unto me? Well, all of those questions, could it be Christ? But God is accusing the false gospel with what they're trying to accuse God, you know, the true gospel with. Because Christ, I mean, who's the chosen man? I mean, it would have to be Christ. Who's a shepherd? This shepherd, there's only one shepherd, Christ. Who is like unto me? Christ. God and Christ are one. Who would appoint me? He's like almost mocking the false gospel. Because when I read that, what comes to mind is when in Job, when in the end, when God was asking Job, who was there when I created the world? Who was there, and so forth. So it could it be possible?
Well, yes, you're bringing up some good points. Now, the first part of the verse, I think I understood. It was the second part that was giving me trouble. Let me read it again. Jeremiah 50:44. Behold, he shall come up like a lion from the swelling of Jordan. I was thinking of that he as Christ. Unto the habitation of the strong. And the strong relates to Babylon, because in Jeremiah 5:15, God brings a mighty nation, and the word mighty is the word strong, against Judah. So Jeremiah 50 is the context of the judgment on Babylon, and so the one coming like a lion can't be Satan against the habitation of the strong. Satan wouldn't come against his own kingdom, so it I think would have to be Christ. But I will make them, Babylon, suddenly run away from her. And there I think you're correct that the he is referring to Christ, and the her would probably be the body of Christ, the believers, and who it is a chosen man. That I'm going to consider what you said about the second part of the verse, because that's where I was having some difficulties. So I appreciate your call that it could be the Lord Christ that's in view there too.
If you look at Zechariah 11:3, that goes along with this term of the swelling.
Zechariah 11:3, there is a voice of the howling of the shepherds, for their glory is spoiled, a voice of the roaring of young lions, for the pride of Jordan is spoiled. And so that's, the pride is the word swelling?
Yes. Yes, pride is, again, the 49 times that swelling is, 20 of those 49 times is pride, 2 times is arrogancy, 1 time is proud, and, another time is pomp, which, you know, goes along with, 10 times it's used as excellency, 7 majesty, and 5 pomp.
Okay.
But in the negative is pride, arrogancy, and proud. So I was just wondering.
Okay. Well, thank you. I appreciate your comments. And again, I'm continuing to pray for wisdom in this. And your call has been very helpful. Thank you very much. And we're going to go to our next caller now. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please, go ahead with your call.
In light of your study today, Genesis 49:11-12, the two vines and the two donkeys, what they represent?
Genesis chapter 49. Let me begin in verse 10. The scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet, until Shiloh come. And unto him shall the gathering of the people be, binding his foal unto the vine, and his ass's colt unto the choice vine. He washed his garments in wine, and his clothes in the blood of grapes. His eyes shall be red with wine, and his teeth white with milk. Well, this is speaking of Christ. He's the one, the lawgiver, that comes from Judah. He is Shiloh, and we would see the language of binding his foal unto the vine, his ass's colt unto the choice vine. Remember how Christ came in Jerusalem, and he was riding a donkey and the foal of a donkey. So it's related to the coming of Christ and the establishing of the vineyards, or the corporate bodies, the outward representations of God's kingdom to the world. And yes, it could also relate to both vineyards, to Israel and the church. But thank you for calling, and sharing. Let's take another question from Pal Talk at this point. The question is, could you please tell us again examples of God using measures of length as the numbers of days or something similar? I'm referring to the 1,600 furlongs equals 1,600 days. Well, you know, when we come to the book of Revelation, there are many time references that are used in this book. There is 1,260 days. There is 3.5 days, 42 months. We read of 1,000 years that Satan is bound, and or 5 months of Revelation chapter 9. And in every case, without exception, every time reference that uses days or months or 1,000 years, every time reference is not to be taken literally. There is not one literal time reference. And by that, I mean 42 months does not represent 42 months. 3.5 days does not represent 3.5 days, and 1,000 years does not represent 1,000 years. They're all figurative time references, figurative numbers joined together with time by day, month, year, and they all refer to a different period of actual years. The 42 months of Revelation 11 is a figure to represent the duration of the Great Tribulation, which turned out to be an actual 23 years. The 1,000 years of Satan's binding is a figurative reference to represent the duration of his binding of the church age in actual 1,955 years. Therefore, if God, in the context of Revelation 14, if he had said the blood came out of the winepress and flowed for the space of 1,600 days, we would have immediately thought there must be a spiritual meaning to 1,600 days. That is, we would have thought it's a figurative length of time that must represent another actual time period, because that's how it is in every other reference in the book of Revelation. But instead of saying 1,600 days, it says in Revelation 14:20, and the winepress was trodden without the city, and blood came out of the winepress, even unto the horse bridles, by the space of 1,600 furlongs. Now, that's 1,600 furlongs, which is not a time reference. Furlongs has nothing to do with time. But in the Bible, God is able to use various things to point to time. In Genesis chapter 40, we read of Joseph in prison with a butler and a baker. And the butler and the baker have dreams, and they're troubled by the dreams, and they go to Joseph, and the butler goes first because Joseph tells him God is able to interpret dreams. And so the butler tells Joseph his dream in Genesis 40, verse 9. And the chief butler told his dream to Joseph and said to him, in my dream, behold, a vine was before me. Now, that's interesting, too, that in this dream, it's a dream about a vine. And what do vines have to do with? Vines have to do with harvest. They have to do with fruit. And that's exactly what Revelation 14, the context of Christ putting in the sickle, is related to harvesting the cluster of grapes and so forth, and casting it into a wine press. And then it goes on to say here in Genesis 40, 10, and in the vine were three branches, and it was as though it budded, and her blossom shot forth, and the clusters thereof brought forth ripe grapes. And Pharaoh's cup was in my hand, and I took the grapes and pressed them into Pharaoh's cup. Now, when he takes the grapes and he presses them into the cup, what is he doing? Well, he's acting as though he's a wine press. That's exactly what a wine press does. You put the grapes in the press and you crush them to get the juice of the grape out. And so in his dream, he has these grapes and a cup, and Revelation 14 also speaks of a cup of wrath, but here he's pressing the grapes and the juice is coming out. And it says, and I gave the cup into Pharaoh's hand. And then in verse 12, and Joseph said unto him, this is the interpretation of it. The three branches are 3 days. Yet within 3 days shall Pharaoh lift up thine head and restore thee unto thy place. And thou shalt deliver Pharaoh's cup into his hand after the former manner when thou wast his butler. And then the baker comes because he heard it was a good interpretation. And the baker also told his dream to Joseph. And he says in verse 16, when the chief baker saw that the interpretation was good, he said unto Joseph, I also was in my dream. Behold, I had three white baskets on my head, and the uppermost basket was there all manner of baked meats for Pharaoh, and the birds did eat them out of the basket upon my head. And Joseph answered and said, this is the interpretation thereof. The three baskets are 3 days. Yet within 3 days shall Pharaoh lift up thy head from off thee, and shall hang thee on a tree, and the birds shall eat thy flesh from off thee. Well, what can we gather from this? We can understand that in these dreams that the butler and the baker had, they dreamed of a vine and branches, and the butler did, and the baker dreamed of three white baskets on his head, and it was interpreted by Joseph. But remember, Joseph declares that interpretations belong to God. Later, when Pharaoh will bring him forth, he'll make that statement. Interpretations belong to God. So this is God's interpretation of three branches equals 3 days. Three baskets equal 3 days. Now, what do branches have to do with time? What do branches have to do with days? The answer is nothing. What do baskets full of baked goods have to do with time? Nothing. And later when Pharaoh dreams, and he dreams of seven good stalks of corn and seven bad stalks of corn, and the seven bad eat up the seven good. And when he dreams of seven fat cows followed by seven skinny cows, and the seven skinny cows eat up the fat cows. And the interpretation is that the seven good stalks of corn are 7 years, and the seven evil stalks of corn are 7 years. And likewise, the seven fat cows are 7 years, and the seven skinny cows are 7 years, and the dream is one. What do stalks of corn, the number of the stalks of corn, or the number of cows have to do with time or years? The answer is nothing. But God is able to use things in the Bible to represent other things. That's why he taught us that he speaks in parables. And so in a parable, he can speak of a field, and the field can represent the whole world. or he can speak of fish that are caught in a net, and the fish represent men. Fish aren't men, and the field isn't the world, but this is the Bible. This is how God wrote the Bible. And branches and baskets and cows and stalks of corn have nothing to do with time, but this is the Bible. And God writes in parables. And that's why when we come to Revelation 16 and God speaks of 1,600 furlongs in the context of Judgment Day, and then when we find that 1,600, that, well, first of all, we know Judgment Day began on May 21, 2011, which was the 8,400th day of the Great Tribulation. And then when we put together this number 1,600 with 8,400, and it comes to 10,000 days of overall judgment, immediately we're very interested, because that would be a number of completeness. And when we also find that 1,600 days from May 21, 2011 falls on the last day of harvest in October 7th, 2015 is the last day of Tabernacles, which in turn is also the last day of the Feast of Harvest or Ingathering. And it's in the context of harvest that this number is given. Well, then how can we help but think, well, maybe since this is the Bible and Christ spoke in parables, that he's giving us a number in association with a word that of itself has nothing to do with time, but the spiritual meaning of the 1,600 furlongs has application to 1,600 days. And in doing that, since it's in the book of Revelation, and if he gave us just plainly stated 1,600 days, we would immediately think it's a figurative number. Yet by using the word furlongs, the spiritual meaning can be 1,600 actual days. And so there is all sorts of biblical precedent. I just read in Genesis 40 and other places for God to speak of other things as though they represent time. So there is no difficulty. Of course, you're going to find people say, well, show me where furlongs are called time. And that's the same argument that people make when they say, or that the church makes when they say, well, where God has specifically said that something is to be understood parabolically, such as in Galatians 4, speaking of the two sons of Abraham, Isaac and Ishmael, one of promise, the other born of the bondservant, and God says it's an allegory. All right, there we'll reluctantly, but we'll allow you to understand those things parabolically. But where God does not specifically call it a parable, you can't do that. That's the argument of the church and its theologians. But Christ spoke in parables to teach us to look for the spiritual meaning and to look to see if it's possible what God might have in view. And so we don't need any specific reference in order to allow a spiritual understanding of something. We just have to make sure that everything is fitting and harmonizing. And can anyone deny that the number 1,600, in the place it's found at the very conclusion of a chapter dealing with Judgment Day and harvest, that number, when it itself added 8,400, totals 10,000, is not extremely interesting? And when that number happens then to fall on the last day of harvest, 1600 days from May 21. Wow, that is an amazing thing when it concludes the passage of harvest, the passage of God's judgment in Revelation 14. But thank you for sharing. And let's go to the next person on the phone. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Hello, Chris. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can. Please go ahead. If you are going to explain how the Lord Jesus is called the Son of God before he dies on the cross, how is it that he's called the Son when God says that he's declared to be the Son via the resurrection? Then if you're going to explain how that's possible, you can continue with your call.
Well, since you asked me to do that, go to Romans 1:4, because I know that's the verse that you used to prove that he was the Son via the resurrection from the foundation of
the world. Well, that's one of many. These things all tie together and fit together. In Romans 1:4, and declared to be the Son of God with power. I'll skip to the end because it's more understandable, by the resurrection from the dead.
Okay, two things now. You got to give me a little time. In verse 4, it's saying declared to be the Son of God with power. It's not saying he's declared to be the Son of God by the resurrection from the dead. He's saying that he's declared to be the Son of God with power. That's a big distinction.
No. You can't go around the statement that he's declared to be the Son of God.
That's the key phrase being used.
Verse 3,
Chris, it says, concerning his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made of the seed of David. Now, in order for him to be made of the seed of David, it's talking about Jesus that walked on this earth. It's not talking about a Jesus that was born before the foundation, that was raised from the dead before the foundation of the world. It's talking about the Jesus that was raised from the dead after he died on the cross of Calvary.
Well, it's concerning his Son Jesus Christ, are you saying Christ came into existence when he was born? No, he has forever been eternal God. And yet God is talking about when he was declared to be the Son. And you know, in Proverbs chapter 30, and God moved Solomon to write Proverbs hundreds and hundreds of years before Christ was born. And it says in Proverbs 30, verse 4, who has ascended up into heaven or descended? Who hath gathered the wind in his fists? Who has bound the waters in a garment? Who has established all the ends of the earth? What is his name, and what is his son's name, if thou canst tell? So, even there, of course, it's only eternal God that has done these things, that has ascended into heaven and gathered the wind in his fist. And even here, some 900 years before Christ would be born into the world, God is in heaven and the Son of God is mentioned. What is his son's name? And so Christ was Son. Even at this point, he was the Son, even going further back, that Hebrews chapter 1 tells us. And let me turn there. In Hebrews 1, it says in verse 2, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. So Christ is the Son. And in verse 5, who created the worlds, he was the Son at the beginning of creation. In Hebrews 1:5, for unto which of the angels said he at any time, thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee, and again I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. Now this language of being begotten ties in with the truth that the Bible teaches, that Christ is the first begotten of the dead. He is the only begotten Son of God, the first to rise from the dead. Well, it's the Son that is the creator of the world. And until you recognize this, you're not going to be able to come to truth. That the Lord Jesus Christ is declared, as Romans 1:4 says, to be the Son of God via or by the resurrection of the dead. That's the point. He's the first begotten. Think about that. He's the first begotten. And that kind of language of first begotten applies to a son. If I think of my children, there was a first begotten child, and Christ is the first begotten. And it was then at that point that he's called the Son of God, because it's by the resurrection of the dead. And yet the Bible insists that all this took place from the foundation of the world. That's when he was a lamb slain, from the foundation of the world. And then he created the world after he rose from the dead to be the Son of God and spoke and brought all this into existence. Well, thank you for calling. And let's go to our next caller. Welcome to our question and answer program this afternoon. Please go ahead with your call.
Good afternoon, Brother Chris. I want to thank you very much for the study in Joel, and particularly the one today. It prompted me to go back to the book of Nehemiah. But before I go to that, I just want to offer up a verse in Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verse 9. In light of some of the callers earlier today and a previous study, I think it was last week, I thought this verse is very helpful.
Yeah, okay, Ecclesiastes 1, 9. The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It has been already of old time, which was before us. And of course, you always get some people who say, well, we have computers. That's new. Or an iPad or phone or cell phone. There's all kinds of new things. What do you mean? There's nothing new under the sun. Well, here God is talking about the things of this earth. The spiritual condition of man is not new. What man does with these new things, these new electronics, is not new. That man takes an electronic device and use it for evil ends is not new. So there, in that sense, there is nothing new under the sun. But yes, go ahead. You had another verse?
Yeah, in Nehemiah chapter 1, I was so delighted hearing the teaching on Joel today when you explained that the Lord Jesus Christ it was with the protection during the church age. You know, as long as the Holy Spirit was there, there was protection between man and God. Once the Spirit left the congregation, the congregation was exposed, naked. In the book of Nehemiah, Nehemiah, which I think is Jesus Christ, the cupbearer, he is the one that is interceding for the those who have escaped the church and are living through the time of judgment. So the building of the wall is the continued protection of God's people on the earth today as we live through the day of judgment, while the broken wall is the church and the world, and their sins are totally exposed to God. But Christ, our Lord and Savior, he is our protection as we live through the period of judgment.
This is one of the problems with Nehemiah and Ezra. They're books after the captivity, and so we know they came out of Babylon, and they returned to Jerusalem, and in Nehemiah they began at some point to build the wall. But we can take certain elements from this book and apply it spiritually to our time, and also from Ezra. However, I think the building of the wall, since God identifies the wall with salvation, and that the wall was built in 52 days, a number that relates to 52 weeks in a year, and we can see then the relationship to the acceptable year of the Lord, which would tie in with the day of salvation, that we can't follow, at least I haven't been able to, follow the understanding that this book, or Ezra, is always and completely describing events after the tribulation and the day of judgment, after the fall of Babylon. So I think we have to look at it like we would just about anywhere else in the Bible, where you have to take each verse and each chapter and each passage on its own. And so within this book, God can have reference to something that relates to salvation, like the building of the wall, spiritual picture. Just as in Joel 2, in the beginning, God speaks of judgment day. And then later on in that chapter, he lays out his programs of times and seasons and reigns. And he also gives language that relates to Acts 2 and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. So if we were to insist, for instance, if I were to say, well, now Joel 1 is the Great Tribulation, and it is, and then Joel 2, we see language of Judgment Day, and then try to force that throughout the whole chapter of Joel 2, it would be an error. And see, from at some point, God stops speaking about Judgment Day, and he goes back and he starts talking of other things. And he can do that in the little book of Joel, or he can do it here in Nehemiah.
Okay. Thank you very much. Take a look at verse 10 of Nehemiah 1 through 11.
Sure. Nehemiah 1:10. Now these are thy servants and thy people, whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power, by thy strong hand, O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name and prosper. I pray thee, thy servant this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. And Nehemiah is a type of Christ. There's some interesting language here, but that could relate to certain aspects of God's program, but I haven't really gone through it very carefully to comment. But thank you for calling and sharing and bringing up these verses. And let's go to our last caller this afternoon. Welcome to our Sunday afternoon question and answer program. Please go ahead with your call.
Oh, hi, Chris. I went back into the queue. John 2:4. When Jesus says to Mary, "This is not my time," she asks him to make more wine. Is that a dual meaning?
John chapter 2?
Yeah.
Verse 4.
Jesus
saith unto her, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come."
She asked to make wine. So what is that referencing?
Well,
there's no more wine, so she asked him for wine, and he replies to her, "My time has not yet come."
Yes, I don't think I can help you with this. These things, you know, we can read it and we get a couple of ideas, and you know, our minds start going in a certain direction, but it's always best to be more careful and to be sure and to, and I haven't done that. I haven't taken the time to go through this, so I'd rather not comment right now. But
okay,
thank you
very much.
And thank you for calling and sharing that verse. I would like to thank everyone for being with us this afternoon and joining us during our question and answer program. We will be going back to our online fellowship for more scripture reading and hymns. Please also keep in mind tonight on Facebook, Lord willing, at 9 p.m., we'll have a text question and answer in the Sunday Open Q&A group. It's an eBible Fellowship sponsored group on Facebook, and all are welcome. You can type it into the Facebook search bar, Sunday Open Q&A, or type my name in, Chris McCann, and I'll help you to find that group if you're interested. But at this point, we will go back to our online fellowship. May you have a good afternoon and good Lord's Day, and may the Lord's perfect will be done.
And thanks for joining us again for eBible Fellowship's Questions and Answers Time with your speaker, Chris McCann. You can join us for these questions and answers sessions Sunday afternoon following Sunday studies and Monday and Friday evenings following the Monday and Friday evening studies. Until next time, may the Lord's perfect will be done.